Okay, Ollie Tomlinson music in chat, I see you. This was going to be one continuous live stream, but then you said that, and I think just out of pure spite, I'm just going to make it crash three times, like last time. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mr. TARDIS, and thank you so much for joining me on a Friday night, as opposed to the usual Wednesday night, for this live stream. So, a couple of things up top. This adapter that I think was the cause of the crashes last week, I have removed. Let's see how tonight goes, because I wanted this to be a pretty quick, you know, a quick experiment, you know, sort of some sort of laid back stream as well, because I think, especially considering last week's stream, we had two guests on. It was pre-recorded interviews, so there was no like way to crash the internet, I guess. But it was also a case of like two people who have dedicated a lot of time and effort and energy and stuff like that to join the stream, and then it crashes twice. And the same goes for Jay when she was on stream a few weeks ago as well. And also that was also a bit of a rough stream because I had COVID then. But also during the last stream as well, before the last stream, I got my first vaccination. I got my first jab, got the Moderna. And then that evening after the stream, thankfully, not during, I got very ill. And then I had vaccine side effects for 2 days. So I've spent basically the past month just knocked out, which is no fun. It's no fun. Darius in chat, is season 24 still drying out? It is. I have not opened it. It's still in the plastic film. Unfortunately, though, I just haven't had time to do stuff, because the reason we're doing the stream on a Friday night this time is because, firstly, I just wanted to wait and see if any news would drop. Good thing I did, because Dalek Universe 2 drops. We'll be talking about that later from Big Finish. But also because I've been away for a couple of days for a location job as well. The same location job that I've actually been away a couple of times for over the past couple of weeks. You know, I'm grateful to have the work. I'm also... I did catch the sun a little bit. I'm not burnt, except on my back. Can you see it on stream? My manly hairy back, you might be able to see the red. So I did get burnt, but still, it's all good. I'm not Piers Morgan coloured anymore, which is positively a good thing. So yeah, that damn adapter from Aidan Woodhead in chat. So... yeah, I think I'll only use this if I'm recording gameplay footage of, like, Destiny of the Doctors or something. I will maybe experiment a bit in, like, unlisted privated streams and stuff to see if this is the cause. But I wanted a laid-back stream tonight. No guests, just us. A little bit of intimacy, you and I. But thank you so much for joining us this evening. Got nearly 50 of you watching. I appreciate your viewership, as always. Thank you so much for coming along. We've got a couple of things to talk about, but I did want to say up top that I am doing a Q&A at the end of this, at the end of the first half. We will be taking a 5-minute coffee break. So I will say, if you do have questions for the Q&A, you've got two options. A, save it for later, because if you do it now, I won't, you know, it will just blitz by on chat and I'll miss it. So save the question for later. Or alternatively, you can support the channel, you can support myself with a super chat. It will appear in a little box on my live stream software. So I can just go back to it and find it. It will be there. You also have it guaranteed to be answered. Obviously, no obligation. I appreciate you being here anyway. But if you are going to be here and not super chat, you know, you can always help to support the channel by hitting that like button and also subscribing. Massively appreciate any support via that way. And also, macro mugs, merch in the description, stuff like that. Dark Prince has already super chatted. It's not a question. It is a GIF. It is a little animated fox shouting higher. So that's lovely to see. But that's not a question, but I appreciate the support. Thank you so much, the Dark Prince. Thank you very, very much. I did also want to give a big shout out as well, real quick. Massive thanks to everyone who's checked out the Rob Shearman interview, because that was a lengthy video, and it was also a great discussion. I'm so glad that Zoom decided to not ever notify me that 40 minutes had passed, and it just kept on going. Dark Prince, if you have got a question for later, you know, feel free, and I'll try and pick you up one for later. Once again, thank you so much for the super chat. If you do have a question for later, save it for later or super chat it. Massively appreciated. Or if you also want to support me, I want to see if this works. The chat might be a bit delayed, but if you if you do have access to emojis, either on desktop or on mobile, macros in chat, put crabs in chat. I want to see if I can make this a thing. Basically, whenever the chat approves of something, or if I want to see if the chat approves of something, macros in chat, see if that happens, get the crabs in the chat. Anyway, so, there we go, here we go. They're already coming. They're already here. Okay, so a big majority of the chat does have access to crab emojis. That's a good thing to know for future reference. Crabs in chat, basically. You need to be now listening to this whenever that... It's flooded. Okay, well, we'll stop now. We'll stop now. We'll stop the crabs. But I'm so glad that test worked. I'm so glad that worked. There is such thing as macro. They're in the chat. They're all in the chat. Depending on how seriously I want to take live streaming in the near future, I would love to see if I can make... Because my fiance does like digital art. She did the artwork for this mug. I want to see if we can maybe get this macro specifically into like an emote or something. Either way, Ollie Tomlinson Music, thank you so much for the super chat. We'll get to that question in the second half of the show. So, let's go to the first news story. It's actually a little bit of a sad one, but folks, I'm going to take you on a journey tonight. We are going to be going for a much happier story later on, but I do want to draw your attention to something that I only heard about on Twitter. I didn't see any like news outlets breaking this. This is pretty insane. Who here in chat, once the crabs have gone, who here in chat lives in London? I also think that Scotland was affected by it as well, but this insane flooding. The reason I've gone for the LBC video on Twitter is because they have credited the people who posted these videos. But yeah, there was flash flooding in London. It was kind of insane. Yeah, there was a major weather incident in London and also some other parts of the country as well. Hopefully you folks are staying safe and there hasn't been too much water damage or anything like that. But we did have a bit of sad news coming from the folks at Time Fracture. Because Time Fracture, of course, we had them on the live stream. I've been meaning to like email them but about this situation. But yeah, Time Fracture, important update regarding performances scheduled between now and the 18th of July. This announcement came on the 14th. If you'd like to discuss your booking in more detail, please reach out to our ticketing team. The producers of Doctor Who Time Fracture regretfully share that performances up to and including Sunday the 18th of July are now cancelled due to a flood in the building, which has badly damaged the set, resulting from Monday's heavy rainfall which burst a storm drain. All customers affected by this will be issued with a credit voucher that you can use to rebook for a future performance. We would be very grateful for your support in rebooking for a later date. However, if you prefer a refund, simply reach out to your point of purchase or email ticketing at artstickets.co.uk. We apologise sincerely for any inconvenience caused. Adam Smith, would August be fine? Honestly, I would... I don't know. I'm afraid not. I actually think they don't schedule any accommodation or any travel stuff for the near future. If you are going to London to specifically see Time Fracture, I would hold off on that for a bit. It's a massive shame. I've not been to the show myself, unfortunately. It is something that I did want to see. But the fact that those wonderful sets and costumes and everything have apparently been damaged to the extent, even if they're fine, you know, the sets and a flood in a building, it's no small thing. It's a massive shame to see that happen. Now, as for the actual logistics of Time Fracture and Immersive Everywhere, which is the company behind Time Fracture, I think that they will, in the end, be okay. This is the type of thing, hopefully, that they are insured for and will hopefully be able to recoup any lost costs, at least in terms of the actual stock, for lack of a better term, the sets and the costumes and the production itself, the practical aspect. As for the lost ticket sales, though, that is, of course, a grey area. If you have booked a Time Fracture ticket for after the 18th of July, please get in touch with Time Fracture. Email ticketing at artstickets.co.uk. Go on at DW Time Fracture on Twitter for more information and updates and things like that. My heart, of course, does go out to the people at Time Fracture, who once again very kindly joined us on stream a few weeks ago. You know, they were a great bunch of guys, clearly very passionate about the project, and it's a shame that this happened. So yeah, that's a bit of sad news. BTS reviews, hopefully they don't have to rewrite or change the story slash show. It depends whether or not they can replace the costumes and the sets and stuff. Really, it's like I said, it's completely up in the air. It is a shame. So let's go to the happier story, the much nicer news story. Because if you remember stream last week, we were joined very kindly by Louis Morehouse, and we were also joined by David Beale, who is the Trusts and Foundations Manager at the charity Living Paintings. And they had a crowdfunder campaign. Well, they still have a crowdfunder campaign. To put together a range of touch-to-see books with the Doctor Who license, and their goal was a £15,000. And I'm very delighted to say that the other day, was it 2 days ago? Wednesday, they did in fact meet that goal. £15,751, with an estimated nearly £3,000 due to gift aid. They do have stretch goals. They are hoping, with a new stretch goal target of £25,000, to create two more Touch to See books with even more doctors, even more characters or iconography from the show. But massive, massive shout out to Louis Morehouse, who has since, like, he's been on Look North. He's been he's been on the news, he's been on radio, he's done like even more like since the stream last week. Dude's been super busy, but a lot of the donations came from a pretty quick last minute surge on like after it came, they came at like 9 a.m. just after 9 a.m. after I believe maybe a news spot, a radio spot specifically, but there was specifically one person who did help to push him over the finish line. Josh Snares. Thank you so much, Josh Snares, you absolute Chad, pledging £20. Anyway, no, it was actually Chris Chibnall who pledged It was Chris Chibnall who pledged £1,000. There's also an extra £250 in gift aid as well. Thank you very much to Doctor Who's Magical Entertainment for the super chat. We'll get to the question in the second half of the show. But yeah, Chris Chibnall, he did, there was a write-up as well. I think Digital Spy. I should have had this ready. It's a chill stream. But he actually did have a statement saying that, you know, Louis is a hero. Louis has done an incredible job putting together a brilliant campaign. So I hope that they do reach their stretch goal. And I did say on stream that if they did reach over £15,000 unassisted by gift aid, they have smashed that target now, that I would play the spoons on stream. I've been too busy this week. I've never played spoons before. And I'm obviously going to try and do a beginner's little crash course on playing the spoons. We'll do that a little bit later on. That's not for tonight's stream. Been too busy. Next week's stream, or... you know, the campaign, Louis' campaign, if you see on the screen, it has 32 days left. There's still 32 days left for them to reach stretch goal targets and things like that. Maybe we'll do it afterwards. Who knows? Maybe we'll try and get Sylvester McCoy on the stream, and he could try and teach me how to play the spoons. So, Pinto Rizvi, we read each other's minds, clearly, because you had the exact same suggestion. Get Sylvester to teach you. He's on Facebook and Twitter quite often, so... that could be something I can try and arrange. At least I could reach out to him. We'll have to see how that goes. So yeah, massive congratulations to Louis. And Cosmic Antics in chat. Mr. TARDIS, will you get a fez? You look good with one. I barely looked good in a trilby. I don't think I'd be able to pull off a fez. But yeah, that's the thing about Chris Chibnall, though, I will say. Aidan Woodhead in chat. Fair play to Chibnall. Good to see the showrunner get involved in these things. That is great. But there's also, like with Chris Chibnall, I know a few people who have worked with him specifically on Broadchurch. They don't have a bad word to say about him. Like, as a person, like, you can criticize his writing all you want, his creative process, whatever that process may be, because we don't know, because there's so much about behind-the-scenes stuff that we don't know. But, he just seems like a stand-up guy. He seems like a really nice guy. So, and of course, he gives £1,000 to this charity. He helps to push it over the finish line. There's more hurdles to go for stretch goals, but that initial fundraising target of £15,000 for Living Paintings, completely smashed. Love to see it. Love to see it. Luke Jenkins in chat, whatever happened to the trilby? Just kind of grew out of it, really. It was kind of when I was... save it for later. Save it for the Q&A. I will actually write that in my notes, because that's a question. That's a good question. Whatever happened to the trilby from Luke Jenkins. There we go. I'll write that down. Put that in the Q&A for later. There we go. Right, let's get to the next bundle of stories, because we have, of course, a lot of big Finnish news that I forgot. There's no we in this. This is all me. We'll talk about this big Finnish stuff that dropped last week. So firstly, there's a press release about a new box set, because they're announcing box sets intensely quickly. River Song is Unit's new recruit. Alex Kingston is back as Professor River Song in her ninth box set of full cast audio adventures from Big Finish Productions. Set for release in October 2021, The Diary of River Song, New Recruit, finds the time-traveling archaeologists back in the 1970s or is it the 80s, to team up with fan favourites Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart, who's going to be voiced by John Coleshaw, and Dr. Liz Shaw, voiced once again by Daisy Ashford, with adventures following everything from spooky folklore in the English village to ambitious scientists overreaching themselves and a good old-fashioned alien invasion. This is a box set not to be missed. We've got four stories here. The Bloodwoods by Elizabeth Miles, Terror of the Suburbs by James Kettle, Never Alone by Helen Goldwyn, and Rivers of Light by Lisa McMullen. Now, River Song, the River Song box sets are, for me, as someone who's only quite recently gotten into the River Song box sets, is uncharted territory for me. You'll see, if you purchase something in Big Finish, there'll be a sticker saying you've got this. I don't have any of these box sets for the River Song stories. But you know what? Because I liked the 10th Doctor and River Song box set that they did last year, and also the Third Doctor Adventures one with John Coleshaw as Brigadier and Daisy Ashford as Liz Shaw. I loved how they captured that era of UNIT so well in that latest Third Doctor box set that I might actually pick this up. I'm kind of making 2021 the year that I properly get into Big Finish, because mainly for the stream as well, because it gives me something to review every week. But it has been a very good year for Big Finish. I can't compare it to other years of Big Finish, of course, because I'm a recent convert, shall we say. But I don't think I've listened to a bad release this year. Even the one I wasn't particularly fond of, from the Third Doctor Adventures Volume 7, The Gulf by Tim Foley, that's still something I do plan to revisit. That is something that I think I needed to be in the right mood for. So I'm going to definitely return to it. Even a story that I wasn't that big on was still something that I thought, I think, in the right frame of mind and with a revisitation, is something that I really could get on board with. So even their subjective miss is something that I'm, you know, really interested in. So Diary of River Song, New Recruit, that comes out in October. I think Dalek Universe 2 is their only big release for this month. Next month, they've got the Ninth Doctor Adventures Volume 2, Respond to All Calls. So I'm looking forward to that. This is also another announcement as well that dropped the week before last, or last week. Two monks are meddling for Missy. Missy is in double trouble in her third box set of full cast audio adventures due for release in September from Big Finish Productions. So further story details and cast today are revealed for Missy and the Monk. We already knew that this box set was coming, but we have a beautiful cover reveal here. We've got Missy in the middle here, and we also have Rufus Hound Monk on her left shoulder, and Gemma Whelan Nun on her right shoulder. So wonderful stuff here. Looking forward to seeing how this pans out. Like I said, it's the same with River Song. I didn't really know anything about the Missy box sets. That is another area of Big Finish that I've not explored. I've kind of mainly been sticking to the main Doctor releases this year so far as a sort of a transitional state, you could say. But I'm looking forward to this. So we've got three stories: Body and Solace by James Goss, Warseed by Johnny Candon, and Two Monks, One Mistress by James Kettle. So this is a good trilogy of stories. Missy and the Monk, of course, available to pre-order CD and digital, this three-part adventure, as well as, of course, behind-the-scenes stuff that happens later on. So, we also did have another press release from Big Finish. This one actually did come out this week, or at least a few days ago. This is something that they could have dropped last week, because they knew I was interviewing Mr. Jonathan Carley, but they decided to hold off a little bit, and they announced details for the second War Doctor box set. So Doctor Who, The War Doctor Begins, Volume 2, Warbringer, once again starring Jonathan Carley, also joined by pseudo-companion played by Beth Chalmers. We've got three stories. So the synopsis here. The Doctor's disavowed incarnation wages war through time in three new adventures. He finds a new friend in street smart cyborg Case, who's going to be played by Beth Chalmers, with the Daleks getting ever closer. So we've got Consequences by Timothy X Attack, Destroyer by Andrew Smith, and Savior by Jonathan Morris. Jonathan Carley is once again returning to reprise the role of the War Doctor. So be sure to have a listen to our interview that we did last week with Jonathan Carley. It was a lengthy interview, but I'm glad that I think I only cut one question from it, from the entire thing. It was a really good chat, really good stuff to talk about. But as you can see, I actually have been listening to a lot of War Doctor stuff recently. I did get the bundle when it was on sale, and I just finished Agents of Chaos, which is the third one. And Agents of Chaos, my dudes, is so good. Like, Eternity Cage is terrific as well. It tells the story of how the Sontarans perceived the Time War and why they weren't involved in the Time War. Dan Starkey, of course, reprises his role as like modern series Sontaran clone template. But it was really good. And Shadow Vortex as well. Because I was kind of thinking with the War Doctor, like, he's hardly on Earth. And, you know, he's so detached because he's part of the Time War. He's not really going to have many Earth-based adventures. But there is one. And it's like a Berlin Wall-esque, like, Cold War thriller. It's so cool. It is so good. Like, the vibe and the atmosphere of it. It's brilliant. Shadow Vortex by David Llewellyn is brilliant stuff. These are really great titles. I thought that Infernal Devices, I thought it was okay. I thought it was pretty good, but Only the Monstrous, Agents of Chaos, mwah, wonderful stuff. I'm looking forward to listening to Casualties of War as well, which actually has like a tribute to John Hurt as well. Like, it's a little behind the scenes documentary. I will say, sadly though, for Agents of War, I think this was recorded shortly after his cancer diagnosis, and he does feel a little bit more haggard than in Infernal Devices and Only the Monstrous. I get the sense that he was a little bit ill when recording this one. So obviously he still gives a great performance, but it was something while listening to it that was kind of on the back of my mind when listening to it. But we, of course, have Jonathan Carley as well, who's done an incredible job of picking up that baton. And I wish him all the best and all the success with these future three box sets. But Warbringer has been announced and is dropping this December. So, looking forward to all of that. 100%. So, let's talk about our next big topic. I'll just take a swig of drink real quick. Thank you so much as well to Jeremy Then's rookie in the chat for the super chat. Thank you so much. It hasn't appeared on screen for some reason though. We'll have to see how that goes. Just give me a second just to prepare. Oh no, what am I doing? Okay, that was not a crash. Also, you may have just quickly seen my YouTube recommended. I watched one Family Guy clip, and now my recommendeds are full of them. I watch one Family Guy clip. YouTube algorithm be wilding sometimes. I do hear claws behind me, though. Winnie has joined. Give me a second. And then we'll get on to the next segment. What Family Guy clip did I watch? It was Lego Spotlight. To be fair, a very funny clip. I've not watched Family Guy in a long time, though. But yeah, I watch one Family Guy clip and then my recommendeds are full of it for a week. That's just how it works, I guess. I had all of this stuff open before the stream, but for some reason it's closed, which is annoying. But yeah, Winnie is in the room. She's just chomping on food in the background now. Might try and bring her on after the break. Anyway. So, let's talk about the latest Doctor Who Big Finish release that came out a couple of days ago, actually. This was a bit of a shadow drop. I knew that this was coming in July, but it's one of their massive big releases. You may remember that a few months ago, I did talk about Dalek Universe 1, which is this big, epic, grand saga involving David Tennant's 10th Doctor. You also got Jane Slavin as a relative of Sarah Kingdom from the Daleks Master Plan. She's playing Anya Kingdom. And we also have Joe Sims as Mark 7, who is this android from the Space Security Service, which is the organization that we had in the Daleks' Master Plan, A Mission to the Unknown. And Mark Seven is this character from the Terry Nation comic. He was the pseudo main character in a abandoned pitch that Terry Nation was trying to get a Dalek series made to American broadcasters, like a spin-off show. But then it didn't happen. But the character has since appeared in comic books, I believe, and has now made his proper big Finnish debut. And this is like the middle of the trilogy, because you've got this epic Dalek Universe saga. Dalek Universe 1, 2, and 3. So these nine stories as well. Dalek Universe 2 has just come out, with Dalek Universe 3 coming out in October. So this is like a year-long saga as well. This epic story that is going to be spanning the 10th Doctor towards the end of his like tenure. This is like his 2009 specials era, with these two new companions as he's somehow teleported back in time pre-Time War, where the Daleks are still around, and he needs to find a way to get back to the right side of the Time War. And he's TARDIS-less. There's no TARDIS to take him there, and he has to try and figure out a way back. And this is such a, like, obviously a love letter to the Terry Nation universe, not just because of the Daleks and, of course, the Space Security Service aspect, but also because this feels like 60s Doctor Who, where you do have these serialized stories. Like these stories, Cycle of Destruction by Roy Gill, The Trojan Dalek by John Dorney, and The Lost by Robert Valentine, much like the last box set, they lead one story into another. This feels like 1960s Who, when the stories would have individual titles and would cross over to each other. Like, what's the story that takes place before the Romans? I want to say it's The Rescue. I could be wrong, but chat will correct me in a moment as they do. But that story ends with the TARDIS on the edge of a cliff. It then falls. That's the cliffhanger. And it then leads into the Romans. That's how you got from one story to another in 1960s Who. Did I get that right? Was it The Rescue? If so, that was an epic guess. An epic punt. Speaking of epic punts, though, that transition happened. So what we'll do is that we'll play a very quick clip from The Trojan Dalek. And I've just realized very embarrassingly that I spelt Trojan wrong on the file name, and everyone is going to see it when I play it. So I've just fixed that. But yeah, so this story, The Trojan Dalek, where you've got this this human colony, more or less, trying to fight against the Daleks, and they need to find a way to do it. So they start building their own Daleks. And the Doctor, of course, has objections.
That's not just irresponsible, that's obscene!
So are the creatures we're fighting.
Meaning what? If you can't beat them, join them!
No, I am fighting fire with fire!
Ah!
The Daleks would see through robots instantly, same with human pilots. This is the only thing convincing enough for their scans, the only way to make the plan work!
Then it's a terrible plan!
The Daleks have devastated Earth, the solar system, the galaxy, countless worlds. If they attack again, we have to have a strong line of defense.
And you're sure that's all there'll be?
Huh?
That's the problem with building weapons. There's the awful temptation to use them.
Earth knows exactly what we're doing.
And you really believe that when they've got a whole army of these, bought and paid for, they're just going to use them on the real thing? Come on!
I have faith in our leader.
Well, I'm glad somebody does, because I don't. What happens if there's a rebellion on a colony world? Huh? Miners going on strike. They're going to send these monstrosities in.
I trust them to do what is right for the solar system.
Well, I'm sure the Carleds thought the same way before they were mutated and fed on a diet of hatred.
So, as chat picked up, there's the Jeremy Themes Rookie, Classic Davidson, and you also get a lot of wells and the high-pitched chat, because he does have such incredible range. And it does sound like a cliche. Ollie Tomlinson said it as well. Even Louis said it when he was talking about the Ninth Doctor box set as well, Ravagers. It's like they never left. It's incredible, these box sets. But anyway, so if you remember my review of Dalek Universe 1, I thought it was a very strong box set. However, it did kind of fall into a cycle where you have the 10th Doctor in this sort of stasis in his 2009 specials, where he knows that the end is near and he's lost a lot and he's still pining for Rose, and everything with Donna is still very raw. But what happened with those three stories basically in a row is that the Doctor would be put in a situation and then he has to have a bit of a low-key chat, and he puts on, like, the gravelly, serious David Tennant 10th Doctor voice, and he's like, no, I've been through this, you can't, what it does to you. Like, that happens, like, three stories in a row, and it kind of hit that groove And it was a good, strong setup to this saga. But I was a bit worried that Dalek Universe 2 and maybe even Dalek Universe 3 would continue that trend. Thankfully, it hasn't, though, because Dalek Universe Volume 2 is a substantial step up from Dalek Universe 1, and that was already a pretty strong start. Cycle of Destruction, the first story, is a story where I don't mean to say this in a bad way, but I think it was reverse engineered from maybe a monthly adventures range, because the actual A plot, more or less, feels like it could happen with any other Doctor, where you've got this research base. Because if you remember the cliffhanger ending of Dalek Universe Part 1, something weird has happened with Mark 7, it's going to crash their spaceship and everything. What happened was that there was this beacon that has been calling Mark to his home where he was built, and it's kind of this facility where these androids are being created, and they're held captive there. They're not allowed to go outside. There's these whole security mechanisms in place which prevent them from going out and kind of getting their own independence. And I think that A plot, basically, of the facility and what's happening, because there's people going missing and there's dead people and there's these androids who are acting a little bit strangely, feels it's better than Robots of Death, I'll give it that, but it does feel like this could be any Doctor in any situation. And that's fine, but I think that maybe they had this as a monthly adventures range idea. They thought, no, we can't get four parts out of this with Peter Davison. Let's put it on the back burner, make it a one-hour story with the 10th Doctor, and then we'll add the Mark 7 stuff on top of it and reverse engineer that. I do think it was good that they added that extra dimension to it, but that's just kind of how it felt like it was reverse engineered like that. Not a criticism, but I felt that when I was listening to it. But I do think this is where Roy Gill does some of his best work. I think Roy Gill as Mark 7 is a revelation in this role, and I think regardless of what happens with Dalek Universe going forward, that I would love to see Joe Sims as Mark 7 get his own box set moving forward. I want to see that box set happen with him, maybe with Jane Slavin as well. I think it's brilliant. He's great, and if you listen to the behind-the-scenes stuff, he sounds like a character from Hot Fuzz. Was like, I'm going to Farmer's Market, going to, you know, Farmer's Mum's. Like, that's his voice. And then when he's voicing Mark, he's got this received pronunciation, very stern android tone, but with the little glimmers of humanity that make him such a wonderful character. He sounds like, on the paper, just a stock, you know, android who's getting these little glimpses of humanity. But I think that Joe Sims really does imbue him with a lot of heart and a lot of dignity and great presence, and I love him in this box set in particular. The story itself is fine. There's a really great twist towards the end for Cycle of Destruction, but I do think the standout of the set is The Trojan Dalek by John Dorney, where we played the clip from earlier. One reason that Trojan Dalek, I think, is one of the highlights of the box set is because there was a weakness in Cycle of Destruction where there's this moral dilemma, and the episode kind of New Earths it, where there's this moral dilemma and it's just instantly shot down by the Doctor, and there's no actual discussion being had in the story itself between the characters, which means that the audience don't get to hear either side of what could be a pretty complex moral dilemma, but the Doctor just shuts it down. Doesn't happen. Which means that the actual ending doesn't quite feel earned. But The Trojan Dalek, though, is an interesting story about, you know, as we heard in the clip, you know, do you create monsters to fight monsters? And no spoilers in the chat if at all possible, but yeah, it's a very haunting ending, a very haunting story where the Doctor, Mark and Annie Kingdom, you know, because this whole box set is them trying to find their way, they're trying to find a temporal scientist called Arborek. That was a loose thread from Dalek Universe 1 that gets picked up on here. And they discover it's like a medical facility, and there's a bunch of like weird Daleks there. You can even see them on the cover art as well. It's not a spoiler to say that they're on the cover art here. You know, these sort of misformed, misshapen Daleks with obvious injuries, and they've kind of been crudely assembled. And I love the characterization of them, the fun that David Tennant's Doctor in particular has with them. I really enjoyed it, and it's also very like dark and morbid, and there's some great callbacks as well to stories such as Genesis of the Daleks in The Trojan Dalek. I love the way that the characters are characterized. There's also one particular incredible gut punch, and it's not maybe the one that springs to mind if you have listened to it, but it's one that happens a little bit earlier on from that, and it doesn't go commented upon. That this really tragic moment for one character in particular, it happens, No one comments on it, but it lingered in the back of my mind as this really sad ending to one particular character who I thought was really well performed and well, and you know, and just well composed and characterized in the story. It was a really great listen. It's the closest thing to a Dalek story in this set, like even considering Dalek Universe 1. It's called Dalek Universe, but there's actually not much Dalek in it, and that might seem a little bit like false advertising. But it was still able to stand on its own. And I think, much like Terry Nation's stuff, even if you took the Daleks out of it, the characters and the themes and the world building, it would still hold up, it would still stand, and I really like that. So we also have the third story as well, The Lost by Robert Valentine. And there's only so much I can say in terms of spoilers, but basically the Doctor and companions wind up in this sort of like pocket bubble universe that is close to collapsing. And they need to kind of open up emotionally to each other. It uses metaphor in a really strong way. You've got this really interesting villain called The Lost. Or I say villain's the wrong word. This sort of opposing force. You know, unbreakable spear, unbreakable shield type force against the Doctor. This really interestingly well-characterized antagonist. That really contrasts well and exposes the Doctor and his companions to the secrets that they've been keeping from each other. And those stories come to a head. And I think that BTS Reviews is right. It's similar to It Takes You Away. It is that sort of more like cerebral, stylized, existential type of story. What I will say, though, is that while the story itself stands on its own really, really well, I think a lot of it will be undone if they don't pick up on those pieces moving forward. Kind of like Series 12, Can You Hear Me? Because that story I thought stood alone pretty well, but because Graham's revelations to the Doctor about opening up about his cancer potentially coming back, because that wasn't picked up on again, in my opinion, it lessened Can You Hear Me's impact, like, on repeat viewings. I think The Lost hopefully will not fall into a similar trap, because there is still another volume. There's still three more episodes, three more stories in this epic saga. But The Lost it's such a departure from all the other 10th Doctor stuff that I've heard before. And I do think while box set one was getting caught in this cycle of the Doctor being like, it's not, don't go down that road, otherwise you'll end up sad like me, and I'm really sad. I was worried that that would happen. The Lost actually kind of pins him down, for lack of a better term, and kind of confronts him on all of it. And it worked really well. And I think Anya Kingdom really came into her own as a companion in The Lost. Because I think Anya Kingdom, while really well portrayed by Jane Slavin, has sort of been a little bit of a hanger-on for about five stories. She's got great moments to shine. And there is, of course, the unspoken subtext of the stuff that happened with the Fourth Doctor and everything. All that stuff. But I was a bit worried that I was actually thinking, I was listening to the Trojan Dalek and thinking, she's not got that much to do. But by the time The Lost came around, those criticisms just evaporated like fairy dust. And it was a really strong story. And I really look forward to seeing where the box set goes next. One thing I love about Dalek Universe 2 in particular, though, is just how varied it is. Like, Cycle of Destruction, The Trojan Dalek, and The Lost are three massively different stories. Like, they feel like they could, if it wasn't for the fact that they were the same, like, three characters, you know, the Doctor, Mark VII, and Anya Kingdom, if it wasn't for that underlying, those characters, they could feel like they could come from, like, any series of the show, or any series of the David Tennant era. You could actually take the baseline story. You could have Cycle of Destruction with the 10th Doctor and Rose. You could have the Trojan Dalek with the 10th Doctor and Martha. You could have The Lost with the 10th Doctor and Donna. Obviously, the character stuff would change, but the settings, the antagonists, the world building would still feel so distinct from the other. And it's great. UT in chat as well. Sounds like they've really started experimenting with 10. I can't comment on Big Finish's past relationship with 10, because I've only heard Dalek Universe, I've heard the Out of Time stories and the River Song box set, I've not heard the other stuff, but it does still sound very experimental. It does feel like that they can't change the 10th Doctor's arc, because that's on the TV. You can't change that. He's always heading towards Waters of Mars and the End of Time. But what Dalek Universe 2 does, though, is that it sort of pins him in that moment in his characterization, forces him to open up, and we learn more about his headspace. And it's the type of thing where, obviously, it's not essential to his arc in the expanded universe and things like that, but I'm curious as to whether or not I will watch the 2009 specials, maybe a little bit differently, by the end of Dalek Universe. Either way, Dalek Universe 3 comes out in October. If you look at that cover, because spoilers aren't covers, we do have Riversong as a Mavellan, Jane Slavin's there, of course, and Terry Molloy as 1980s Davros. So I'm really looking forward to seeing what the directions that that story goes in. We don't have titles or writers or anything announced at the moment. We only have kind of a preliminary cast here. But yeah, Dalek Universe 3, really looking forward to it. This box set series, this saga is going from strength to strength. And I thought it already started pretty strongly, but Dalek Universe 2 was really good. If it wasn't for the fact that Dalek Universe 1 is so instrumental as foundation to Dalek Universe 2, if it wasn't for that fact, I would kind of maybe consider just skipping straight forward to Dalek Universe 2. Dalek Universe 1 is fine. Dalek Universe 1 is good. It's fine. But you do need that prerequisite now. It's just how it's gone. Just how it's gone. Thank you so much, James, for just subscribing on stream. Followed by James's example. And if you are watching this stream, if you've been enjoying my Doctor Who content and commentary and reviews and stuff like that, please consider subscribing as well. Your name appears on the screen. Wonderful stuff. And we also thank you so much to Scott Gerrard's Super Chat, which also reminds me, in a moment, we're going to be taking a quick break, and then we'll be going to a Q&A for the remainder of the live stream. So if you do have questions, think on them while I have a coffee break, and then post them when I come back, because I'm worried that chat might move up and lose them if you ask them now. Or alternatively, you can do what Scott Gerrard has done, you can do what Jeremy has done, Dark Prince, Ollie Tomlinson, and you can super chat them. They'll be on my screen, I'll see them, I won't miss them, and they'll definitely get answered. So, thank you so much for joining me for the first half of the stream. Also, once again, no spoilers for Dalek Universe in chat. It is still such a recent release. One thing that Dalek Universe 1, though, does have on Dalek Universe 2, while I do think Dalek Universe 2 is a better structured and paced and put together, more thoughtful story, Dalek Universe 1 still had that cliffhanger. I wish that the cliffhanger built into something a bit more interesting on a character level. I felt like it was a shock cliffhanger that ultimately, in the end, didn't really add up to much. The execution was fine, and I love the performance, if you know what I'm on about, for Dalek Universe 1. But yeah, Dalek Universe 2 is lacking that, but, you know, swings and roundabouts, Dalek Universe 2 was a really strong box set that I really enjoyed listening to. And Adam Smith with Ant Capone has completely got it. It is the Doctor hanging off a cliff again. Umbrella in hand, you absolutely got it. Call back to season 24. Folks, I'm going to be taking a 5-minute break. I'll be right back. Have those questions ready for when I come back, or super chat them. See you folks in a few minutes.